Hi everyone.
My name is Danielle.
I'm Derek.
I'm David.
And welcome to our live praise and worship
here on FB Live.
As always, it is such a blessing and a pleasure to be in the presence of God with each and every single one of you. So go ahead and take this time to share this with your family. Go ahead and text them, call them, share this link so that we can all praise and worship God together.
Yes, and please send us your prayer requests so we can pray for you. And do include us in your prayers too. So tonight, it's a beautiful evening here in Sacramento. But I know in different parts of the world, it's daytime. But either way, today is the day that the Lord has made. And we can always rejoice because our God is a good God. We can put aside all our cares, our doubts, our fears, our worries. Our God is here. So let's get ready. Let's put the name of the Lord. Let's praise His name and let's give Him our praise. Filled with your blessing, filled with favor for your people. And we believe that you are here right now, God, to meet us. We put our trust in you. We give you our fears, our worries, our anxieties and sorrow. We put them aside, Lord, and lift up your name in worship. We are open, Lord, and we are ready for you. Have your way. Fill this place. Fill us with your presence. We welcome you, Lord. We welcome you in this place.
Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Feel the presence of heaven. And just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside me. Just one word, and you revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch,
nothing is impossible with you, God. So We bring before you our praise, our worship. We adore you, Lord. We lift up your name. We honor and bless you. We give praise to you, Almighty God, our good God, our faithful God, our loving God. Thank you. We praise and worship you. And all this we lift in Jesus' name. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Because there's nothing that our God can do. And with just one touch of our God, we are made new. And now to hear the word of God, to give us the message of God today, here is Mick.
Love that song, especially that part that there is no power but the power of Jesus. Thank you, Santiago family, for leading us to worship. And of course, I'll see you back later. Hang in there. Hello, everyone. It's a good evening here in this part of the planet. And I know it's Saturday morning in the other part of the planet. And of course, it's February, love, love month. So let's all share love, love, love to everyone. And I'm so excited because, again, you know, we all came from different places and different time, and yet we only came for one purpose, and that is to just be in the presence of God and hear His word for us. And I am so ready. I know you guys are ready. So let's do this. We're going to look at the book of Luke, chapter 7. We're going to dig deep into the New Testament chapter. This is the chapter started when Jesus was in the town called Capernaum, and he was in the shore of the Sea of Galilee where he healed the centurion's servant. So the next day, Jesus traveled around 15 to 20 miles north to the city of Nain. Okay, Nain. And there he goes with a large crowd. We're going to read that later. He went with a large crowd. Of course, that time Jesus has become so popular. He had a lot of followers in his Instagram and Facebook page, you know, if you know what I mean, because, you know, because of all the beautiful teachings, the wonderful miracles that he was performing, and people were actually witnessing it. So there is an air of excitement and expectation in this crowd that was with Jesus. They were actually waiting for what would Jesus do next. But see, when they entered the city of Nain, on the opposite side was also a big crowd coming towards them. But this crowd, however, is not joyful. They're not excited. There is not an air of excitement about them. Actually, it's just the opposite of the crowd with Jesus. They were weeping. They were wailing. They were mourning. They are not following a man who's feeding them. They're not following a man who's giving them words of life and great teachings. Instead, they were following a widow and her dead son. So we're going to read Luke 7, verses 11 to 17. Okay, if you don't have your Bibles and you're new in the faith, don't worry. Right there, we're going to flash it for you. Okay, so verse 11 of chapter 7 of the book of Luke. Let's start. Soon afterward, Jesus went with his disciples to the village of Nain, and a large crowd followed him. A funeral procession was coming out as he approached the village gate. The young man who had died was a widow's only son, and a large crowd from the village was with her. When the Lord saw her, his heart overwhelmed with compassion. See, this is one of the common emotion that Jesus felt during his earthly ministry, is compassion to the hurting, compassion to the lonely, compassion to the outcast. As a matter of fact, the Greek translation of the word compassion in this context is splagna, okay, splagna, which means the compassion, it's coming from deep within his soul. Okay, so that was the kind of compassion Jesus had with all the people that he has encountered. And then, don't cry, he said, or don't weep in other versions. Then he walked over to the coffin and touched it. Okay, he went over to the coffin and touched it. And then the bearer stopped. Young man, he said, okay, I tell you, get up. Okay, say this with me, get up. Okay, get up. Then the dead boy sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. Jesus gave him back to his mother. So it was such a beautiful reunion. Just imagine that. And great fear swept the crowd, and they praised God, saying, a mighty prophet has risen among us, and God has visited his people today. See, God is also going to give us a visitation today. Do you believe that? Do you agree with that? Tell this, Lord, I'm going to receive a visitation from you today, right here, right now. Okay, and then the news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and the surrounding countryside on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Snapchat, whatever you have out there for social media. All right, so that is the word of God that we're going to get into. We're going to learn a lot from the Lord. See, he came and touched the coffin, and that is our main message today. He came and he touched the coffin. We are going to find out what happens when Jesus collides with our grief, when Jesus collides with the dead things in our life, when Jesus collides with what we think is finished, okay, in our life, or zero, okay, nada in our life. We are going to look at what happens when Jesus actually touches our box, our coffin, because with one touch of Jesus, it can bring about breakthrough and it can bring about new beginnings in our life. So the title of our message is Just One Touch, and we're going to pray. Lord, we just want to thank you and praise you, Lord, for this moment that we share, this moment that we gather. Thank you, Lord, for your beautiful words about you colliding with our grief, colliding with our moments of hardships, colliding, Lord, with the bad times in our life, that Lord, with one touch, just like what you did with the boy, we know that we are also going to come back. We are also going to come back to life. And so, Lord, speak more, O Lord, of your message, and may we just have the heart to receive and the heart to accept every word that you're going to speak to us tonight. And we know that there is no power like your power. And so speak in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen, amen, and amen. Type the word amen if you want to. All right, so interesting that when you look at the meaning of box in the Webster Dictionary, of course, the regular meaning or what we know of a box, it is a small compartment with a lid on it, okay? But if you're going to scroll down further, one meaning of a box is a coffin. So a coffin is a box, okay? So we're going to use the word box instead of a coffin, okay? So here is a widow who had lost her husband. We don't know the reason why. We don't know how, when he lost her husband. But this time, he's also dealing with a tremendous grief and loss because her only son, the only family left, her heir, her only protector, her provider has left her and left her in a very young age. Okay, and not only she was grieving, she was actually in a bad place, a horrible place, because in this dominated society, you know, when a woman lost or loses a man in her family, she's actually pretty much on her own. Okay, she's an outcast. She would depend on somebody or anybody, just basically for scraps, okay, from their table. That's how bad it is for her. So there, she had not a bright future ahead of her, okay? So they're on their way to the grave to bury his son, and the woman was with a large crowd. Of course, they were playing sad songs, funeral songs. They were crying, weeping. Everything was just sad and sorrowful, tears, moaning, groaning. And then here comes on the other side of the road was Jesus with his big followers and... you know, they were actually singing. I was just imagining this, you know, when you receive a blessing from God, when you receive a miracle from God, aren't you like just so happy and so excited to the point that you just want to sing? So probably, you know, one of them were singing, you know, I was lost, but now I'm found. Another is singing, I was blind, but now I see. Another one was singing, walking and I'm leaping and I'm praising God. And somebody was probably singing, I'm alive because Jesus gave me life, right? And probably some are singing, through you the blind will see, through you the mute will sing, through you the dead will rise, right? Because they were just so excited. They were healed by the Lord. They experienced new life. And so they were, there was this joyful praise party going on, okay? And you've got this super sad funeral, you know, atmosphere going on the other side, and then the two collide, okay? The two collide. See, when they collided, okay, Jesus turned to the mother and said to the mother, don't cry anymore, don't weep anymore, and then, you know, don't weep over your child. And see, I want us to see this. I want us to see this powerful scene right here, because I believe today, okay, that Jesus wants to collide with the sad songs, with the sad moments, with the sad stories, the sad episodes, the sad seasons of our life. He wants to he wants our praise to overcome our sadness. Jesus wants our praise to overcome what we've lost. Jesus wants our praise to overcome what we think is finished, is done in our life. Jesus comes, okay, and meets us right there where you are, right here where I am right now. He will collide with the bad things. And then let's look at verse 14. It says here, when Jesus collided with them and told the mother, do not cry anymore. And Jesus is telling us right now, verse 14, then he walked over to the coffin and touched it. Okay, and touched it, and the bearer stopped. See, what Jesus did here was super shocking. Okay, and not only super shocking, but it was completely scandalous in the time of Jesus. Okay, the people would gasp everywhere. The Pharisees, the religious leaders would actually faint because this is unlawful. Okay, they had 613 plus laws in the Torah, the Bible, in those days, and they're very strict in following these rules. Okay, and one of the rules says that anything, don't touch a dead body or anything that touches a dead body, because if you touch a dead body or anything that touches a dead body, you are unclean. Okay. So Jesus actually touching that coffin makes him unclean. Okay, but see, when Jesus touches the coffin, when Jesus touches the box, when Jesus touches that coffin, he actually crossed the line. And this is something I love about the Lord. I love about Jesus that every time religion, every time the world, or every time people, you know, would draw a line, okay, Jesus would always cross that line. Okay, Jesus did radical ways in his time, in his earthly ministry. People did not understand why he was doing it. He showed them that his grace is beyond the laws of man. Okay, Jesus breaks, you know, Jesus, you know, breaks the what people think was wrong in those days. He would do whatever it takes, okay, to touch people's life. He would do whatever it takes. He would cross the line just to change people's life, because that is what he came here for, is to change lives, is to touch lives. And with just one touch, say this with me, with just one touch, and then with just one word, say this with me again, with just one word, okay? And he told the young boy, and he said, get up. That's all he needed to say, get up. And the boy sat up, and the boy began to speak. See, last week, I just told you that sometimes the deepest things that God, Jesus would speak would always be in the form of the simplest word. Remember, he says, be quiet to the storm. And then he said to Peter, come. And now he's telling this dead boy, get up. And notice that when the boy got up, the scripture tells us that he talked, he started speaking. Okay. And what the Bible did not tell us what the boy was, you know, talking about, what did he say? Okay, but if we're going to base it with the traditions of those days, okay, which is this, when a male dies in your family and there is no more other male in the family, the men in the community, in your community, can actually come in your house and take all their stuff, their shoes, their clothes, their hats, whatever. And then what they do is they wear that in the funerals, okay? And so when I think what he said was, when he get up and then he looked around, he's like, hey, that's my shirt right there, or hey, that's my trousers, that's my hat, that's my shoes. And he's probably telling them, I want it back. Give it back to me. I am not dead. Okay, so give it back to me. See, today, my dear brothers and sisters, the devil is a thief. Okay, in John 10:10, it says there that the devil or the thief comes only to steal and to destroy. But Jesus says, I came to that you may have life and have it abundantly. Okay, and so when Jesus touches our coffin, when Jesus touches our box, when Jesus touches the empty things in our life, the lifeless, the barren things, the barren areas in my life, and when Jesus tells us to get up, we can actually tell the devil that, you know, we can actually take back whatever the devil has stolen from us, and we can tell the devil, you know what, devil, give me back my joy. You know what, devil, give me back my dreams, give me back my passion, give me back my health, give me back my expectations, my great expectations about God's plan for me. Give me back my faith. Okay, devil, give me back my peace, the favor that God has given me. Give me back the blessing that God has for me. Give me back the success that God wants me to experience. Give me back my victory. We can tell the devil who is trying to steal what God has given us to tell him, give it all back to me. That's mine and ain't yours. See, we don't have to live our life in a box full of limitations. Okay, because that is what the devil wants us to happen in our lives, is to put us in a box. And then what he does is he limits us, he traps us there, and then he puts a lid on us so that we will not escape. Okay, for the enemy wants us to just stay in the box, because the longer we stay in the box, that box becomes our coffin. Okay, but with one touch of Jesus, we can take it all back. Say this would be, with one touch of Jesus, I can take it all back. I can take it all back. So maybe, you know, you are in a box right now, box of depression, right? Box of anxiety, so much anxiety going on, box of loneliness. You have nobody else to run to or to go to. You're in a box of drug addiction, whatever addiction it is, alcoholism. You're in a box of mourning and grief. You can also be in a box of spiritual dryness. You don't feel any, you know, you don't feel the presence of God, and you just don't know what's happening. But today, okay, we are going to have a collision with the power of Jesus Christ, because there is no other power than the power of Jesus. And when the power of Jesus collides with all those ugly and bad stuff, we are going to get every good thing back. This is what we need today. We need one touch, just one touch. Say this with me, just one touch, Lord. Just one touch from the author of life. Just one touch from the giver of life brings the dead things in our life back to life. Okay, we're going to come out alive and new and fresh. See, the widow and the dead son only needed just one touch, just one moment, just that one collision, just one word from God, and everything changed in their life. See, in the Old Testament, the presence of God was kept also in a box, and we call that the Ark of the Covenant. We read that in the Old Testament a lot. And they believed that God is in that box, which is, of course, man-made box. And if they had that box, they also had victory. And if they don't have that box, they don't have victory. They had defeat. See, the Old Testament actually is a book about a God who is in a box, in the Ark of the Covenant. That is the symbolism, the representation of God. Every time the Ark of the Covenant is there, they believe that God is also there. But Jeremiah prophesied, and he said that there will come a time when men will no longer wish, you know, the Ark of the Covenant, but he said that there will come a day, there will come a time when the Lord himself will be among us. And that is why the Old Testament is not about books about God in a box, but the New Testament is the Word made flesh, and now he dwells among us. Jesus came to dwell among us. This means that Jesus is not restricted and confined in a church building. Jesus is out of the box. He'll go anywhere and everywhere. He'll go into your homes. He'll go into my home. He'll go into the messed up marriage. He'll go into the broken family, the brokenhearted. He'll go to the lost and the hurting, the rejected, the unwanted, the place of the worst sinners. He will go there. He's going to go everywhere and to whoever needs his touch. And when Jesus touches the lives of those people, my life, your life, we are never going to be the same again. When he touches our coffin, when he touches our seasons, when he touches our current state, because he is bigger than our problem, we would be amazed of that there are more reasons now for us to praise him. There are more reasons for us to sing songs of adoration than to fear, than to be sorrowful, than to be depressed. Jesus wants to collide with our current situation because Jesus wants us to get out of the box. That is why he came here on earth and died on the cross, because he wants to get us out of the box so that we could be the person that he has called us to be. See, notice that he didn't touch the boy, okay, but he touched the box. He touched the coffin. He touched the thing that held the boy back. Now the boy got out of the box because of that one touch from Jesus. See, when Jesus touches your box, whatever kind of box you're experiencing, the coffin that is holding you down, when Jesus touches those things that is holding you down, when Jesus breaks the power of that box of your life, there is no lid, there is no cover, there is no limit, there is no holding us. Our problems cannot hold us down. There is no stopping us from going where Jesus wants us to go. And there is no stopping us from doing whatever God wants us to do. And to close this beautiful teaching, this beautiful message, you know, the story started with sadness and sorrow. But, you know, before the touch of Jesus, the widow was at loss. She don't know what to do. She doesn't know what's going to happen to her yet. She had no direction, no sign of hope, no relief, no stability in her life at that moment. And most especially, she had no future for her. She was just going to feed off scraps. That's going to be her life. She's going to be at the bottom. But with one touch of Jesus, mourning was gone and it was replaced by hope. Okay, sorrow has no hold on her. Sorrow has a hold on her. Before the touch of Jesus, the boy was dead. He was clinically dead. He was physically dead. He was lifeless. He was actually going towards his grave, to his final destination. Okay, but with just one touch from the giver of life, from the resurrection life, you know, the box that was holding him, life came out. Life came out. Life came out. See, I don't know who or what is carrying you today in your grave, that you feel that is it for me. I don't know anymore where to go. But see, what I know is that Jesus will stop whoever and whatever is bringing you to your grave. Okay. I don't know who is singing sad songs out there. But what I do know is that Jesus is about to put a stop to that sad song, to that sad lament, and is going to put a joyful song in your heart. Right now, I believe that. Believe that as well. I don't know who has put you in a box at this very moment in your life, but I want you to believe that Jesus will get you out of the box right now. Right now, just one touch and you're out of that box. Just one touch and you're out of that box. I don't know who says you're done out there, you're giving up, but I know Jesus is just beginning something new in your life with just one touch. Get ready to be touched by Jesus right now. I don't know what's put you in your burning furnace. Okay, remember the story of the three friends, but what I do know is Jesus is going to walk with you in that burning furnace. He's not going to leave you. He's always going to protect you in that fiery furnace of your life. I don't know what brought you in your prison cell, that you feel trapped and you know, chained. But what I do know is Jesus will just, you know, break those chains and you are going to set free with just one touch. And I don't know what brought you your storm in your life. I don't know what kind of storm you're experiencing right now, but I know Jesus is about to collide with the wind that is against you and to make you walk on water with just one touch. Believe it right now, that with just one touch, there is hope. With just one touch, there is cure. For Jesus is coming towards you right now. He's coming towards you. He's coming towards me. And he is ready for that one moment, okay, wherein his goodness and his grace will collide with whatever barrier, with whatever kind of box that we feel that has separated us from the love of God, whatever it is that we feel that, you know, it's making us think that God has forsaken us. God is ready to collide with whatever is holding you back. With just one touch, he will turn our graves into garden. With just one touch, he's going to give us beauty, you know, from ashes. With just one touch, he's going to turn those dead bones in our life and bring it to life. And with just one touch, he will turn shame into glory. See, with just one word, with just one word, the boy got up. And with just one word that Jesus is going to speak to your heart right now, you are going to get up. I am going to get up, and I'm going to get out of the box. And you are definitely going out of your box. See, we are free with just one touch from Jesus. We are free, and we are staying free. Say this with me. I'm staying free. With just one touch, we are out of the box, and we're staying out of the box. With just one touch of Jesus, we are delivered, and we are staying delivered. As I would like to call back the worship team. So my dear brothers and sisters, with just one touch, remember, with just one touch, you know, Jesus can turn whatever is holding you and bring you life, bring you blessings and favor and increase. And now I would like to invite all of you, touch that area in your life, or think of that area in your life that has been in a box right now. It's been in a box, and we're going to pray. We're going to pray as our worship, you know, team just, you know, puts music. And Lord, just picture Jesus right now coming towards you. He's ready to collide. He's ready to collide. Be excited right now. And we pray, dear Lord, we pray in your mighty name, who is the resurrection life, that you would touch those who are hurting right now. Touch those who are afraid. Touch those who are confused. Touch those who are sick and suffering. Touch, Lord, those who are in an addiction, in bad habits. Touch those who feel alone. Touch those who are lost. Touch those people that can't find any more meaning in their lives. Touch those people that are questioning if there is still God. Touch those people that are under severe trial and tribulations right now. Touch those people, oh Lord, and all, and let your powerful touch collide. Collide with all the bad, with all the ugly, the miserable things in our life. And with just one touch, oh Lord, get us out of the box. With just one touch, get us out of the box. And this is what we claim, Lord. Now, Lord, we have received your touch. We have received your touch, Lord. With just one touch from you, Lord. Just one touch, just one word from your mouth. Just one moment with you, Lord. We are now alive. And we are taking back everything that the devil has stolen from us. Take everything that the devil has stolen from us. And we now can look with expectations, Lord, for new beginnings, fresh start, for great favor, our victory, Lord. And this is our prayer in Jesus' powerful name. Let us all sing together. There's nothing that our God can do. Jesus.
There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a prison one he can break through. Oh, break the net and make some way. There's nothing that our God can do. Sing. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Let's sing out. There is no power like the power of you, Lord, and let us, let faith arise, and let us all agree, and let us claim this in Jesus' name. With just one touch, we are all saved and healed and delivered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. And in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. One more time. Can you get all the amens?
Amen.
Amen and amen. Well, thank you, Lord, for that beautiful message. Just keep that to heart and claim that you've already been touched by the Lord, and go ahead and start your new life with Jesus. And so before I head over back to our worship team, of course, we have a lot of events going on this year, 2021, for all ages. So we have events for married couples, single parents or solo parents. We also have events for young professionals, the single people out there, for our youths and our kids. So just go to our website, www.lordsflock.org, and Facebook pages, of course, for more details. And please also subscribe and like our YouTube channel. You may replay all the messages that you have heard or missed. So go to our YouTube channel at Lord's Flock Official. And of course, after this praise and worship, we are having digital meetups in the area of Los Angeles, Bakersfield, Daly City, Las Vegas, Nevada. So please join us. If you want to join, just comment down below and someone will get back to you. Again, happy weekend, everybody. God, with just one touch of Jesus, we are all brand new. So worship team, lead us to our closing song.
All right, thank you, Meg. There you have it. You got the word of God. We are so filled today by his favor, by his blessing. So keep praising, keep worshiping. Remember, God can calm the storms in your life with his one touch. God can set you free from that prison that you're in with just one touch, and he can do everything for you. So let him touch your life and be free.
Yeah.